Fox 4 and the Kansas City Star present Four Star Politics.
Memorial Day weekend, as Americans pause to remember those who made the ultimate sacrifice in serving their country, the Liberty Memorial, a Kansas City reminder. And on this weekend, a chance to reflect on veterans who made it back from conflict but faced their own battles on the home front. Today, serving those who served on a very special edition of Four Star Politics as we welcome you on this Memorial Day weekend. John Holt, Dave Helling, and Dave, we do use Memorial Day in the weekend to gather the family together, have sort of the unofficial kickoff to summer and remember those who've passed. But there are those who come back and have issues to deal with as veterans of war.
Well, right. And of course, the commitment of our country, John, has always been to take care of those people.
Right.
And the question really is that commitment being met even now for those who fought so bravely for our country in whatever service they provide?
Well, part of that commitment is being met by private organizations. An organization in our town that you may or may not be aware of, and if you're not, you will be, Friends in Service of Heroes. And Paul Chappa, the founder, one of the founders of FISH, as it's known perhaps better. Paul, welcome.
Thank you.
We appreciate your insights on this Memorial Day weekend. Before we dive into some of the things that these veterans face, tell us about FISH, how it came about, and what your mission is.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Dave, for having me on. So I'm in the food industry. I own a trade journal for the grocery industry. 9/11 happens, and what can an old guy like me do? I can't serve now, but surely I can find a way to serve those who are. And so I decided to call on some friends in the food industry to help me put on a dinner. It all started with a dinner in Cherry Point, North Carolina at a Marine Two Stars home, his quarter. And I had a friend of mine, celebrity chef Rick Tarantino, join me. And we've now done about 37 dinners across the country since January 2011. It was in 2013 with that general at the time made a statement that night at the dinner. After all the young Marines and spouses left, we're outside enjoying a scotch and a cigar, John, and the general said something I'll never forget. He said, Paul, America's not at war, they're at the mall. Excuse me? It's 2013.
Yeah.
No one cares. America's at the mall. No one will ever know about these Marines except for their mommies and daddies and fellow Marines. And that statement, America's not at war, they're at the mall, it just struck me. And after we left, I said, guys, we got to do something. It's great that we're the food industry. One of the guys said, we are the food industry. Guys, we're fish. We're going fishing. What are you talking about? Food industry serving heroes. Feed a man a fish, feed him for a day. Teach him to fish, feed him for life. We've since changed the name to Friends in Service of Heroes because it's just no longer the food industry that's supporting what FISH is doing. It's everyone. And in a community like Kansas City, it's just been extraordinary to see, you know, the people and the businesses come together to help us.
Do you find veterans are ready to reach out for the help they need from your organization, Paul, and organizations like it? I mean, sometimes there's a reticence or a feeling that somehow I need help, but I don't really want to try and get it. Do you find that, or is there...
Absolutely.
Are people welcoming you and other groups like
that? That's a fantastic question, because most of the vets that we serve, they don't come to us. We call it going fishing. We go find them. So we're remissioning the community to be our hands and feet to help us find these men and women that will never ask for help, because the vets that really deserve the help, need the help, they're never going to ask. In the times that we've approached them, usually it's the same thing. You know what? I'm okay. Give it to someone that really needs
it. That's really a part of service, isn't it? That you don't ask for help when you need it.
It is.
Right.
That's absolutely right. So we don't ask them, you know, if it's we've gotten houses out of foreclosure, we've helped with a lot of different things, but we don't ask. We're telling you. We're volunteering you. We're taking care of this aspect of what's going on in your life, and then we're going to do life with you. We're going to pour into you. You're going to be a part of the FISH family, and we're going to do things together, because that's the only way that we get to know where they really are and what those needs may actually be, because there's some that are pretty visible, pretty noticeable, but then there's some that as you get to know them and spend time with them, you realize that they're still struggling with anxiety and other different things.
So. We touched on it at the top, at the open, and that is these veterans come back from conflict or wherever they might have been, and they face new battles on the home front, right? And you managed to meet some of those needs with service dogs. It might be mobility. And I think viewers may be asking, well, now, wait a minute, why does it take a private organization to do that? Why isn't the federal government, the Veterans Administration, providing those services?
Right. You know, a lot of veterans believe that, you know, going to the VA, number one, they've heard all the stories, the nightmare stories about the waiting in line and people doing things out in the parking lot. I mean, they've waited enough. There's so many struggles. They don't want to go in there and be told, no, no, no. I mean, we recently surprised, and that's how Fish does it, a woman that had been turned down for several years for a mobility chair, has spinal stenosis. We found out about it, heard about it. We stepped in the gap.
Turned down by the VA.
By the VA. And so we step in the gap. It might be a mobility chair. It might be, you know, helping with rent. It may be, in many cases, a service dog. I mean, mm-hmm. You talk about, you know, our Vietnam veterans. I know you're going to have Art Fillmore on. Vietnam veterans, 30% of the Vietnam veterans that came back still suffer from post-traumatic stress. And that's just our Vietnam veterans. You know, Iraq, it's 12 to 20% of them. Really? And we found that these little furry angels make such an impact on their lives. They're game changers. They're life changers. Yeah.
And those little furry angels, they have to be trained. They right. have to be prepared.
Acquired,
trained, and fed.
That's right.
And that's one way Fish steps in when you go fishing to help these veterans
that's
out. We're
going to
continue here on 4-Star Politics on this Memorial Day weekend. Paul Chapa, our guest, we hope you'll stay with us as we salute Memorial Day and the veterans who are continuing their own battles on the home front. We're back here on 4-Star Politics this holiday weekend with Paul Chapa, Friends in Service of Heroes, better known as Fish. And Paul, during the break, we were talking about the vest you brought, which of course the dogs wear.
That's right.
Tell us the significance.
Well, the vest is probably one of the first things that we give the veteran when they receive their dog. And what we like to do is find out a little bit more. And we have a lot of info on them, Vietnam veteran, et cetera. What we do, we decorate the vest for the veteran.
Oh, wow.
Because when they're going down the street, people aren't just seeing some guy approaching them with the long hair or the beard. You know, they're seeing one of our nation's defenders. That's the message we want to share with the community. And we hope that that person either stops and gives them a smile or tells the veteran, welcome home, or thank you. We want the veterans to be seen. You know, without the vest, it's just a dog and a guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You talked a little bit about the Vietnam era veterans that you may work with, Paul. And of course, there are younger veterans,
right.
too, from Iraq, other deployments. Is there a difference between them? I'm familiar with the Vietnam era. That's kind of my era.
Right.
And of course, there was a draft, and the service tended to be a bit more universal. And believe me, nobody back then said, hey, they're at the mall, they're not at war.
Right.
That's changed so much. Do you find a difference in those cohorts, if you will?
There is a difference because, you know, the post 9/11 veterans, you don't see them spending time at the American Legions or the VFWs, not like their predecessors. You know, pre-9/11, you could go find them at the American Legion, which made it easy for us. And that's why the fishing is so important, because there's too many veterans out there, you know, post-9/11 that are sitting at home doing nothing. So what we're trying to do is engage them to get them off the couch, out of the house, and engage. So we do a monthly event called the Fish Speaker Series, and we get them there. And it's so cool because you start seeing these young men. Now they're looking into the eyes of a sergeant major from the Vietnam era or the Korean War era or like Max DeWeese from World War II. And all of a sudden you see the pride coming back, and you see that, you know, if they can do it, I can do it too. I don't have to sit at home and see life just pass me by.
Yeah,
I need
to
engage, and we're trying to engage them.
Yeah.
Paul, we have about a minute left here. Talk a little bit about, none of what you do is free.
Right.
It's free to the veterans, but it costs money. How do you raise the money? Who's supporting you?
And how can people contribute if they want?
Thank you very much. Yeah, absolutely. We have no salaries with Fish. No one's getting paid. You know, I'm the guy that started it. My wife would tell you it's a full-time job, and it is. But it's something that has to be done. And so we do little events, like we have our Fish Combat Golf Tournament, our 9th annual coming up June 13th at Falcon Lakes. But our website is friendsinserviceofheroes.org. You can go there, go to our Facebook page. But, you know, we have no big donors. We have... You know, we've never received a government grant or anything like that. It's just people doing all that they can, a little bit that they can. That's how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time.
Yeah.
And that's how we
did
do it.
Did you invite Holt to your golf tournament?
I have. I've invited him for years.
He's a scratch
Joe Lauria has played before.
Yeah, it's just one of those little things called work that keeps getting in the way. But I'm very familiar. I was a part of the recent Military Appreciation Day.
Right.
Normally Armed Services Day, you had to hold it a couple of weekends earlier. But what a great turnout and what
Thank
a great
you.
Day it
and
was.
And what a great service you provide.
I appreciate that.
And we should point out, I don't think we've mentioned, he's not a veteran himself. Paul Chappa just fell
not
in love with those who have served. So,
well,
Paul, thank you, all of those who are involved in Fish Week.
And good luck to you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul.
We're going to continue our chat here on 4-Star Politics. We'll shift gears a bit and talk about another challenge for many of these veterans when they come home, and that's, for some of them, having a home. Fox 4 and 4-Star Politics continue. On this Memorial Day weekend, 4-Star Politics is remembering those who've served our nation, those who didn't make it home, and on this Sunday morning, those who did but faced new challenges here at home. And before we introduce our next guest, we should share with you that he is a Vietnam veteran and just several weeks ago was honored with the Roger H.C. Donlan Patriots Award. He served, as I mentioned, in the Vietnam War, and this award is named after the first Medal of Honor honoree in the Vietnam War and Special Forces, Roger Donlan. He and his wife, Norma, call Leavenworth home. They were there to present that honor to Art Fillmore, our guest today, attorney and veteran. And Art, you're in good company. Gary Sinise was one of the Patriot Award winners, along with the founder of Wreaths Across America. Congratulations to you. Well earned, my friend.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And Senator Bob Dole was the other one.
Yes.
I told him they need to step up their game. They've taken a dip here.
I don't know.
Well, the Mendoza line.
Yeah. I'd say you've done well, not only in serving
your
country.
You've served this community for decades, yes. Haven't you, Art? And it's great to have you with us.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I first got started with the veterans community in 1985 when we did the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, and I was chairman of that. And if you remember, got defaced, and the infamous Del Dunmeyer came in and saved the day and helped us finish it.
You know, the cohort of Vietnam vets is shrinking, I assume, already here and in other places as we all get older. How are they? In your own experience, how are the Vietnam-era vets doing?
I think they're doing better now. They went so long without help. Because they didn't know help was available and people frankly weren't willing to give it to them. They're aging and they have the same problems that people who are aging do. But I think they've come to grips with the fact that some of the younger veterans who served in the Gulf Wars come up to Vietnam vets and said, thank you, because of the way you were treated, people realize it's about the warrior, not the war. When they talk to a veteran, and that all changed, and a lot of people still today are saying, you know, 35 years later, thanks for your service.
And as it should be, they're learning to accept that graciousness as well. We heard Paul Chappa talk about the PTSD numbers, but another issue facing many Vietnam veterans and other veterans as well is homelessness. Why? Why are we seeing that, and what's being done to help them?
Well, PTSD is a big part of it. It causes you to dysfunctionality in your home, in your life, drugs, alcohol. And after Vietnam, people didn't want to talk about it or deal with it. And it's
or even admit that it existed, right? Art, in
to give you an example, when I came back from Vietnam, my mother was a teacher. I'm from St. Louis, and she asked me to come talk to her class. I wore civilian clothes to her school, changed in my uniform in the bathroom, spoke to her class, went back and changed again so I wouldn't be ridiculed. I wouldn't wear my uniform in public. Now it's a sign of courage and service.
In many ways, though, these veterans who are homeless, you're fishing for them too, aren't you? You have to find them to provide the services. They're not coming to you for help, right?
No, we reach out. We started the Heart of America Stand Down in 1992, and it's a couple of days of you know, anything you need if you want to get off the streets, services, food, haircuts, et cetera, jobs. And it led to St. Michael's Veterans Center, which I'm involved with now, which is a 23-acre campus of permanent housing for homeless veterans. And it's been as rewarding as anything I've ever done, because you take people who've been on the streets all this time, whether they're couch surfing or sleeping in their car, or sleeping in shelters or whatever, and you put them into a permanent apartment, beautiful apartment on a beautiful campus. And we have had, since we started to open about 8 years ago, 96% of our veterans who've moved into a permanent housing apartment are still permanently housed. That's incredible.
Yeah, great to hear. Can you talk to us a little bit about the Veterans Administration medical system and the VA hospital? Because I think, obviously, the veterans with what you're familiar with are now increasingly using that service. And every story I've ever done has suggested that the quality of care is high, but access is very difficult, has been for many, many years. Is that still the case?
Yes, it's overcrowded, understaffed.
Here in Kansas City?
In general, but here in Kansas City, too. It's actually I get treated better at the VA than I do a normal provider, civilian provider. But when I got out of the Army, I had some injuries I had to deal with. I'm from St. Louis. I went to the St. Louis VA, and I literally, you talked about this a little earlier, but I followed lines for 6 hours without ever being triaged or seeing a service provider. And I walked out of the door, and I said, I'll never go to the VA again. And that was the perception, that was the reality of the VA. VA's come a long way since then, but it can only do so much.
Yeah. I want to come back to the homelessness in the St. Michael's Veterans Center, because I think it does more than just provide a home. I want to talk to you about that. I know you're on the board there. We'll continue with Art Fillmore as we continue our special edition of Four Star Politics this Memorial Day weekend. We're back here on Four Star Politics with Art Fillmore, Vietnam veteran, attorney, but also activist for veterans. And one of the keys we've talked about is the homelessness issue in the St. Michael Veterans Center. It's not just about, as I understand it, providing them housing, but also transitioning them, getting back into the workforce so that perhaps they can build a life of their own.
Right. And we've got sort of a continuum of care ecosystem now for homelessness. We start off with a stand-down program, which is just a one-day event where we get things out to people that we can. And now we've got the VCP, the Veterans Community Project, which has almost the opposite goal of St. Michael's. They are there to transition people to be ready for a place like St. Michael's where they can be permanently housed, because permanent housing is the solution to homelessness, period.
Yeah.
And so we have a great relationship with VCP.
Do you have a pretty good relationship with the city of Kansas City and from
Fantastic.
The private sector helping you in this project, Art?
We do. Sly James was a great friend. Quentin Lucas has been a very good friend. Congressman Cleaver has been forever. Frank White is. But we are a private 501c3 at St. Michael's, and so we do have to do our own fundraising. We've gotten some tremendous partnerships, like with U.S. Bank, which buys low-income housing tax credits, which allowed us to build these beautiful apartment buildings.
Is there a bigger role for government to play? I touched on this with Paul Chappa in our earlier portion of the show, that people might be surprised that the government's not doing more. Is there a bigger role for the government to play here, or is it better left to the private sector?
I would say that the government can't afford to do everything that the private sector can. It's like the permanent housing. The VA can't do that. Build a bunch of things like we did with the public-private sector and tax credits. So, and a lot of people still have a very bad perception about the VA. They view it as a monolithic institution where they'll be treated as an item rather than a person. I couldn't get greeted more friendly than I do when I walk in the VA. I didn't even know I was eligible for the VA.
Did they provide the mental health services, Art, that your clients need?
They do.
Adequately? I mean, is it the quality you would expect and want?
They do it at a couple levels. They have the VA, which deals with it on the medical level. Then they have vet centers, which treat with social workers. And social workers really get into PTSD. They bring the family in because they're affected by that. And the VA does all it can, but it needs help. And a lot of people don't trust the VA, yeah. Which is unfortunate. But they're really understaffed. It's like I usually use private physicians. I haven't had anybody at the VA for over a year now.
Keep up the great work.
I appreciate it.
Men like
it.
You and women like you continue to support our veterans as Fish does and your group as well. So congratulations again on the Patriot Award as well.
Thank you for emceeing. I appreciate
that. That was a good night. Fun night. Art Fillmore, Paul Chappa, it's been a wonderful morning. Thank you for joining us.